Welcome to the second part of our lecture on sound recording and reproduction. In the first part, we became familiar with the psychoacoustic principles of stereophony. In the second part, we will have a look at the techniques of stereophonic recording and reproduction. Let's recall from part one that the term stereophony is used both as a mode of reproduction with at least two loudspeakers and as a technique of spatial encoding where you have as many transmission channels as you have loudspeakers and where the interchannel signal differences are used to produce phantom sources between pairs of loudspeakers. In the history of audio, the number of channels used for transmission and reproduction has constantly increased. From the mono layouts of the first recording devices with cylinders and gramophone records, to the first experiments with two-channel recording in the 1930s, to the first stereo recordings for disc and for radio in the 1950s and 60s. The 1970s saw an unsuccessful attempt to introduce multi-channel audio with quadraphonic records, as well as the successful introduction of multi-channel stereo for cinema. And it was not until the advent of digital audio that multi-channel stereo became available also as a consumer format in the 1990s. According to the current convention, we denote the number of front channels and the number of lateral and rear channels separated by a slash, and the number of low frequency effect channels separated by a dot. So 3/2.1 means 3 front channels, 2 side and rear channels, and 1 effect channel for the subwoofer. If you now want to use a pair of loudspeakers to assign locations to individual sound sources or to place the image of an extended sound source such as an orchestra on this sonic stage between the two loudspeakers by using appropriate time and level differences, there are two options. You can either send a mono signal to both loudspeakers with a level difference introduced electronically. This is called panning and is part of every hardware or software-based mixing console. The implementation of these panning curves can differ a little with respect to the middle position of the control knob. Sometimes it attenuates the signal by 3 dB, aiming at a constant loudness compared to the left and right position and assuming incoherent signals from the two loudspeakers, so that two loudspeakers with minus 3 dB would sum up to 0 dB and produce the same loudness. But sometimes the attenuation is a little higher, something like 4 or 4.5 dB, assuming partly coherent signals from the loudspeakers. The other option is to use a stereo microphone and record sound sources so that their spatial characteristics will be encoded in the two channels already at the recording stage. Consequently, you can categorize recording techniques into those that produce only interchannel level differences or interchannel time differences or both, with binaural recordings as a special case. No matter which technique you choose, the properties of the recording system can be characterized by 3 values. The first is the included angle between the reference axis of the left and right channel microphone. This makes sense, of course, only for directional microphones because omnidirectional microphones are usually aligned in parallel. The acceptance angle then describes the angle between the directions where a maximum time or level difference occurs between left and right. And the recording angle describes the angle between the directions where the time or level difference is not maximal but sufficiently large to produce a fully left or right stereo image. This is the most meaningful value because the sound sources, which are located within the recording angle, will just fill the stereo panorama from left to right at the reproduction. Microphones which produce only interchannel level differences include different combinations of directional microphones mounted immediately above each other with a certain included angle. Here you see three popular examples. For example, the Blumlein configuration, which you see at the right, is named after the inventor of stereophony and was used for the first experiments with stereophony in the 1930s, and it uses two figure of eight microphones with an included angle of 90 degrees. Using the directivity of the microphones and their included angle, the resulting recording angles can be calculated. For example, for the Blumlein configuration with a figure of eight microphone and an included angle of 90 degrees, we are around here, and get a recording angle of about 75 degrees. Thus, sound sources within an angle of 75 degrees from the microphone will fill the stereo panorama from left to right. Since the concept of the recording angle is sometimes not immediately clear, let's take a short break and have a little quiz. So the question is, what happens if you increase the included angle of a pair of directional microphones? There are four options. And you can stop the video for a moment and think about which one is correct. Well, the third option is true. If the included angle is increased, the recording angle gets smaller, corresponding to a stereo image getting broader on the loudspeaker panorama. Let's have a look at systems which produce only interchannel time differences and no level differences. These can be realized with a pair of spaced omnidirectional microphones. The interchannel time difference and thus the recording angle then depends on the microphone spacing and the angle of sound incidence according to a simple triangular expression. From the recording angles, you could see what happens if you use two microphones at ear distance, which I mentioned as the result of confusing interaural and interchannel differences. So, below 40 centimeters microphone spacing, the recording angle gets infinitely large, which means that such a configuration is not able to produce a sound image which fills the stereo panorama at all. To reach this, you need a microphone spacing of at least 40 centimeters. Mixed recording systems, of which I show only two popular examples, produce interchannel time and level differences. And listening tests have shown that the position of the phantom source will just result from a linear combination of the time and level effect. And so the recording angles can be calculated accordingly. I will not go into details here, nor will I address the special case of binaural microphones, which are treated in detail in Chapter 8 on binaural technology. Instead, I want to have a look at the recording techniques for multi-channel stereo, for example, with three channels in front and two surround channels, which are recommended to be reproduced either with two loudspeakers or with two pairs of loudspeakers. As we saw in the first part of this lecture, the lateral loudspeakers can hardly be used to produce a stable phantom source. So the question remains what to do with the three channels in front. And here, two approaches have established. One approach could be called stereo plus center. It uses the left and right channels as a classical two-channel configuration and the center channel as an additional mono source. This can be used, for example, for the dialogue in film sound, while only left and right channels are used for the music, or for solo voices like the vocals in a pop mix. A second approach uses three microphones to feed the three front channels and tries to segment the stereo panorama into one part between left and center and one part between center and right. The potential problem of such a configuration is that every sound source will produce three phantom sources between left and right, left and center and right. And these phantom sources will never appear at the same position. This can only be controlled by using directional microphones in order to attenuate the unwanted phantom sources. With two more recent systems, a gradual transition is marked from a channel-based encoding to an object-based encoding of audio sources. What I mean with this is demonstrated by the next system. With vector-based amplitude panning, signals can be rendered for massive multi-channel configurations. And instead of sending a channel for each individual loudspeaker, sound objects are encoded as single channels, such as a voice or a musical instrument, while the position of this sound object is stored as a separate metadata stream. The rendering software will then reconstruct the intended position, in this case by using a triplet of the nearest loudspeakers and a panning algorithm to produce a phantom source inside this triplet. So from a psychoacoustic perspective, it is still a stereophonic system, but the spatial information is not encoded by interchannel signal differences, but by independent metadata. Dolby Atmos, intended as a new format for film sound, follows a similar approach. Sound objects are encoded as single channels, while the position and the movement of these sound objects is handled separately. For example, making the sound of a helicopter move through the movie theater. It is obvious that the transition from channel-based to object-based audio encoding entails a radical change of production methods, where the production gets partly independent of the loudspeaker configuration because the signal can be automatically adapted by the rendering software. And thus, the techniques of stereophony and sound field synthesis, which are described in Chapter 9 of this series, move somewhat closer together.